الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وكريمنا وشفيعنا وأولانا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصلي عليه. I greet one and all with the universal greeting of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. After praising Allah Almighty and His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I welcome you to another edition of the Sunni Path. Alhamdulillah, today we are going to discuss something which will benefit us in our lives, how rulings change according to the situation. This is more about fiqh, about understanding. And it's very important when once we have understanding how to apply it and how to use it. Certain things can change according to the situation. Rasulullah ﷺ, he told us that seeking of knowledge is compulsory upon every Muslim male and female. So we have to go out and we have to seek knowledge. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that may yurid Allah bi khayran yufaqihu fi al-deen. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants with him good, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him the understanding of the deen. So to understand the deen is very good. To understand the religion is very important. Because without understanding, condemnation without understanding leads to tunnel vision and incorrect judgment. Condemnation without understanding leads to tunnel vision and incorrect judgment. We have to understand what are the different rulings in the Sharia. Once we have these different rulings, then we can apply it. Let's take the example first of how a ruling will change from one aspect to another. If we look at Salah, which is a fard action, and we look at wearing the cap or the turban as a sunnah action of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, both these actions fall under permissibility in the Sharia. One with a higher ranking and higher intensity level than the other. And this, at the end of the day, gives a different ruling. So if somebody does not perform Salah, or say, for example, if somebody rejects Salah, we know Salah is fard, to wear the cap is sunnah. If someone rejects Salah and he says Salah is not fard, he will become a kafir. And if someone rejects to wear the turban or to wear the hat and they say no, that's not a sunnah, then that person will become a fasiq, a sinner. And if the person who doesn't make salah, he doesn't perform the salah, he will become a fasiq. But on this side, a person who doesn't wear the turban, which is a beloved sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ and encouraged, and if he doesn't wear it, he will not be punished. He will not be punished in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we see the difference. Here we have salah, which is fard. Here we have a turban, which is sunnah. If the person rejects salah, he becomes a kafir. But if a person rejects the turban or the amama, he will become a sinner only, but he won't become a kafir. If the person doesn't perform salah, he'll become a fasiq. But if a person doesn't wear the turban, he won't be a sinner. As long as he's not rejecting that this is a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we see how the rulings change. Here the person don't do an action totally, he will become a sinner. Here he won't be a sinner. If the person rejects it, he become a kafir out of the fold of Islam. Here he will only become a sinner. Here a person understands that it is fard, and here he understands that it is a sunnah. So the rule of something will change according to the circumstance, according to the nature of a thing. We'll start off by reading chapter 5 in this book, is standing while praising Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sunnah or bid'ah. It says, There are many examples in fiqh dealing with the changing of rulings according to the change of a situation. The first example we are going to discuss is the example of adhan. To give the adhan is sunnah mu'akkada. To give the adhan is sunnah mu'akkada, which means it's an emphasized sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But this is on a communal basis, based on the community, on a level where the entire community will come to the masjid. It is sunnah mu'akkada to give the adhan. Sunnah mu'akkada means that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam done it most of the time, majority of the time, 98% of the time. And once or twice or a few times, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam left it out. But meaning it's an emphasized routine sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the adhan is very important. On a communal level, on a community level, it is sunnah mu'akkada. And if a whole community agrees that, listen, we are no more going to give the adhan, we are stopping the adhan, then the ulama of that time or the governing bodies, the Muslim societies, will have to battle with that community until they start to give the adhan again. So the ruling is that they cannot just forsake the adhan. They have to give the adhan because it is a sunnah mu'akkada, and if they all agree to leave it, then the community or the society will battle with this community to tell them that you have to give the adhan. But on an individual level, this was on a communal level. Now on an individual level, if a person leaves out the adhan, he will not be punished. If a person leaves out the adhan, he's not obliged to give the adhan. So we see the difference. It changes from a communal level where it's sunnah mu'akkada, and the imma and the imams and the ulama bodies will have to battle them if they totally leave it out. But on an individual level, the ruling has changed. So the ruling of a matter changes according to the situation. The second example, jihad. To go and strive in the path of Allah Almighty, when the enemy is attacking the Muslims, to fight in self-defense. This will be the jihad. When you're fighting in self-defense, it is fard kifaya. Fard kifaya means that if some people do it, it will fall off the rest of the people. The rest of the community will not be punished. If some people act upon it, the rest will not be punished. So in fard kifaya, people will go out, a group, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Holy Quran, a group of people will go out and they will fight in self-defense for the community or for the country. And when they are fighting in self-defense, the obligation falls off the rest of the people. But it's not a fard ain specifically on each person to go. So the ruling is fard kifaya. But it comes to a time that it can change to fard ain. It's an individual duty. Each and every person will have to act upon it. Fard ain means, take example, salah. Salah is fard ain. It is compulsory upon every individual. It's not that if some people perform salah, then the rest will not be punished. No. Each person is responsible for himself, and he has to fulfill these duties. It is compulsory upon him to fulfill these duties. So when we look at the words here, fard ain and jihad, when will it come? The only time it will become fard ain is if the government, if the president, he gives out a command and he says that all males, example, over the age of 20 will have to go and fight. So now if I'm over the age of 20, then I have to go and fight in self-defense of the country. If someone is attacking our country and then the government gives the law, then I have to act upon it. So now jihad will become fard ain. So we see how the ruling changed from fard kifaya, which was compulsory upon some individuals, and it changed into compulsory upon all the individuals of a certain level. Fard ain upon everyone who is over 20, example. So it changed from fard kifaya to fard ain. If we look at another example, a judge. Every locality, meaning a province or a locality, had to have one judge. So the government will choose one judge. This is according to Islamic law. So they will choose this judge and he will give judgment. Now if this judge, to be a judge is fard kifaya. It is not wajib upon a person. Say example, if I have the qualifications of being a judge, it is not compulsory upon me specifically, Sayyid Harun, to be a judge. It's fard kifaya. If someone is a judge, khalas, no one will be punished, no one will be in problem, no one will be liable that there is no judge. But now if it comes to a time that Sayyid Harun, he is the only man who has the qualifications to be a judge, and there is no one else in the entire area, in the entire place, or they cannot even bring a judge from outside. And then the president says that, listen, Sayyid Harun, you have to be appointed as the judge. Then it will become fard ain. So it changed from fard kifaya to fard ain for me to be a judge. The fourth example would be the example of a scarf. A Muslimah, she has the free will. She can wear a scarf in the house or she doesn't have to wear. So it is not compulsory and not fard upon her to wear her scarf and her hijab, meaning her modest dress. And modest dressing for a Muslimah is, it has to fulfill two conditions. Number one condition, her entire body must be covered. And number two, it mustn't be exposing. So if it's thin, it will be exposing. If it is tight, it will be exposing. So she has to be, her entire body must be covered. That's one of the conditions. And number two, it mustn't be exposing. Her face can show and her hands. Besides that, and her feet. Besides that, her body has to be covered. Head to toe, she has to cover her body with modest dressing. So these are the two conditions of Islamic dress. It doesn't have to be an abaya or something. Even if she is wearing a loose pants and a long top and a scarf and she's covered, alhamdulillah, the lady, a sister, a Muslimah, she have come to dress as a Muslimah. She have fulfilled the requirements of dressing as a Muslimah. Now my topic here is about wearing the hijab. She don't have to wear hijab in the house as long as there's no non-mahrams. She has a choice. But when she decides and makes this decision that she wants to go out of the house, then she has to wear hijab. Because now it becomes fard upon her. So first it was optional in her house. But once the situation changed and she had to go out of her house, it becomes fard for her to dress modest and to wear the shar'i requirements of hijab. She has to cover her entire body and it must not be exposing. So this is how a ruling changes from one ruling to another ruling based on the situation. So once the situation changes, then the ruling changes. Our fifth example would be of a person standing and sending salutations upon Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you are alone and when you are in a gathering. When you are alone, you can stand, sit, sleep, relax, however you feel comfortable to send salutations upon Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Once I was in the masjid and I said that you can stand, sit and sleep and send salutations upon Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some people looked at me very strange. Sheikh, what are you speaking? Because they were under the influence and the impression that when you are alone, you have to only stand also and send salutations upon Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Allah says, فَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَىٰ جُنُوبِكُمْ. Remember Allah standing and sitting and even when you are lying on your sides. Meaning in any position you can remember Allah. So if Allah is the greatest and we can remember Him in any position, then obviously we can remember Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam in any position. So now we're talking of the ruling when you are alone. Remember Allah, however, remember Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and send salutations and salawat, however you are comfortable. But when you go into a gathering, if everybody is sitting and remembering Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, don't be rude and disrespectful and stand and say, no, I'm respecting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because it's sunnah taqriri. Respect the gathering and sit and send salutations upon Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If everybody is standing and sending salutations upon Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, don't be rude and disrespectful and sit and say, no, it's a bid'ah to stand, when we already proved that it is a sunnah, taqriri, and approved sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And if a person has an injury, or is old, or is sick, if there is a valid reason, that person is allowed to sit when everyone is standing, or stand when everyone is sitting, as long as they have a valid excuse. We say a ruling changes once the situation changes. We have to understand that sending salutations upon Rasulullah ﷺ, once you make the intention that you are going to join a gathering, and if they are all standing, then stand and praise Rasulullah ﷺ. In the same way, once a lady makes a decision that she wants to go out of the house, then it becomes fard upon her to wear her scarf. So the ruling will change. So once you make a decision to join that gathering and they're all sitting, then sit. The whole thing is that a ruling of Sharia changes according to the need. Once the situation changes, that's when the ruling will change. Some people will use the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and say that some hadith says there is prohibition in standing. So whoever likes the people to stand up for them, then they must book their place in Jahannam. This is a hadith of the Prophet. He says that if you love people to stand for you, then you must already book your place in Jahannam. So how can you all stand for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? In reality, this is the first hadith. The second hadith, they would say the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited you to stand like how the Arabs stand for their kings, or like how the non-Arabs stand for their kings. So the two hadith. Now they want to apply this hadith on Rasulullah. The first hadith is clear that whoever wants people to stand for them, Rasulullah was so humble, he never wants people to stand for him. And it will create arrogance and hatred. And some people are so arrogant that if people stand for them, it goes to their head. But Rasulullah was free from this. Rasulullah was free from pride and arrogance. So we cannot even apply this hadith on him. And the second hadith, Imam Nawawi rahimahullah mentions that this means those people, these kings who used to stand and he used to sit down, but the followers or the subjects, they used to remain standing for hours. Rasulullah was so much a great rahmah for us. So he never want anyone to be put in a problem or a difficulty because of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hazrat Anas radiallahu anhu says, so we understood these two hadith. It is circumstantial and it has a certain reason in the wisdom. The third hadith is that Rasulullah says, Sayyidina Anas says, there was no one more beloved to us than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one more beloved to us than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But we still, when we saw him, we never stayed because he disliked it. The point we're making here that Rasulullah disliked it because he never wanted difficulty, because out of his humility, out of his humbleness, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How do we prove this? That he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will never prohibit one thing and then do the same thing himself. Unless there is a wisdom and a reason. And this reason, what we are proving here, that it is circumstantial. It was for people who are vulnerable to pride and arrogance. And Rasulullah is free from that. He is totally free from that. He is above that. And Rasulullah, he never wanted to give people difficulties because he was such a rahmah and such a mercy, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He will never contradict himself. Look, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he saw the leader of the Ansar, Sayyidina Sa'ad, he told the people, Kumu li sayyidikum, stand up for your leader. So now here he himself is commanding the companions that they must stand up for Sayyidina Sa'ad. So if standing was prohibited, the Prophet ﷺ would never contradict himself. So it's not that the standing is prohibited, but it's actually the circumstances and things which are surrounding the standing. It's not the standing in itself. Because he sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he stood out of respect also. When Sayyida Fatima to Zahra used to come in his gatherings, his beloved daughter, he used to stand up, he used to kiss her and make her sit in his place. And when he used to go to her house, she used to accord him the same respect and honor. She used to stand up and kiss Rasulullah and let him sit. When the uncle, Imam Bukhari mentions that when Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu anhu used to come, Rasulullah used to stand up and used to kiss him on his forehead and then let him sit. So to stand out of respect and honor of Ahlul Fadl, of people of virtue, is allowed. And it is not disallowed. As all the great a'imma, like Imam Nawawi, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, Badruddin Aini, Imam Ahmad Rida, Mawlana Muhammad Zakaria Kandalvi, all these great a'imma, they have mentioned in their kutubs and they explained that the permissibility of standing. They only show that these ahadith, which shows and indicates apparently the prohibition, these prohibitions are circumstantial to a certain reason. Now Rasulullah, as Sayyidina Anas says, that they never stand for Rasulullah because maybe he disliked it. Now someone will come, how can you claim that you love Rasulullah and still stand for him when he disliked it? We already proved that it is circumstantial. But look, that when it comes to adab and respect and manners, then al-adab fawq al-amr, the respect supersedes the command. We will prove this from the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, when Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one day he wasn't there, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Hazrat Bilal said, you be the imam. So while he was performing salah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came in, and Abu Bakr, he moved back. So Rasulullah gave him an indication, oh Abu Bakr, remain. Prophet gave him an indication that he must remain and carry on being the imam. But he came back, and Rasulullah went and he completed the salah. After the salah, Rasulullah said, oh Abu Bakr, why did you not stand in your place when I gave you an indication? I gave you an indication, I commanded you to stand and remain in your place. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu responded, Ya Rasulullah, how can Abu Quhafa, how can Abu Bakr be in front of Rasulullah, in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu? So he showed adab and he showed respect in front of the command. The Prophet said, wait there, but he still showed respect. So when it comes to matters of adab and respect, then the adab can supersede the command. This is what Sayyidina Abu Bakr done, and the Prophet ﷺ did not rebuke him. The Prophet did not prohibit him. So if adab did not supersede the command in respect of, in the regards to respect, then the Prophet would have definitely stopped it. The Prophet wouldn't have approved it. Take the example of Hudaybiyah, this hadith also in Bukhari, where Sayyidina Rasulullah ﷺ got Ali radiallahu anhu to write, and when Hazrat Ali was writing the contract and the treaty of Hudaybiyah, he wrote Muhammadur Rasulullah, Muhammad the messenger of Allah. So the Quraysh said, no, erase that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, because he is not the messenger of Allah. Had he been the messenger of Allah, we wouldn't have been fighting with him. We don't accept this. So the Prophet told Sayyidina Ali, oh Ali, erase Rasulullah. Sayyidina Ali says, no, Ya Rasulullah, I will not rub out Rasulullah. I won't be that person. So Rasulullah erased it himself. Here the Prophet gave him a command to rub it out. But out of adab and out of love of Rasulullah, Sayyidina Ali did not rub the name of Rasulullah off. And the Prophet approved of this. Same with Sayyidina Hassan bin Thabit. He stood up for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says, قِيَامِي لِلْعَزِيزِ عَلِيَّ فَرْضٌ وَتَرْكُ الْفَرْضُ مَا هُوَ مُسْتَقِيمٌ. My standing for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is compulsory upon me, and leaving in compulsory action is incorrect. عَجِبْتُ لِمَنْ لَهُ أَقْلٌ وَفَهْمٌ عَجِبْتُ لِمَنْ لَهُ أَقْلٌ وَفَهْمٌ يَرَى هَذَا الْجَمَالُ فَلَا يَقُومُ. I'm very astonished at those people who claim that they have intellect and they claim that they have understanding. They see such beauty of Rasulullah and they don't stand. And Rasulullah smiled and he approved of this. So we learn that a ruling can change according to the situation and according to the person. If a person is a person of fadl and respect and honor, then we will honor him and respect him. And we know that standing while praising Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a sunnah taqriri, an approved sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And no one can deny this fact that standing is a form of respect, because we proved it from the Holy Quran and sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instill in our hearts the true love for Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Instead of trying to belittle the high status of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, let us also respect and honor Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.